Hey, look, there are no dangerous exercises. So in terms of exercises, none of them are dangerous.
All right, guys. You're going to get blasted.
Wrong. You know what? You know why I want to say that? Because oftentimes you'll hear people say things like upright rows are bad for the shoulders, or if you do a lateral with your pinky higher than your thumb, that's bad for your shoulders. Or if you do a squat pull down
behind your neck.
Yes. And the reality is, if you have the required control, stability, and mobility in connection to doing that exercise, it is not a dangerous exercise. What makes it dangerous is your body and your lack of ability to control and mobilize.
You couldn't help yourself. We were supposed to explain all that.
Yeah.
this is actually an interesting conversation, because there's more to that. You know, I remember being a trainer in the first like 5 years or whatever, and you start to build up a little bit of knowledge and experience, and then you go through this phase where you kind of probably think you know it all or whatever. And I see this a lot, and I see this exaggerated in social media life, right, or world or whatever. Yeah. And you see a lot of trainers and fitness people that like to point out people doing, you know, quote unquote, stupid exercises.
Mm-hmm.
You know, oh, it's a stupid exercise, or oh, it's a dangerous exercise, or oh, they shouldn't be doing that, or that's, they're an idiot, or like calling out people that are exercising when you don't even know who that person is. And I fell into that trap of being like that, you know, seeing, you know, knowing a little bit enough to get me by, to teach others, to get in shape, and knowing what is considered dangerous for most people, or exercises that don't give you a lot of benefit for most people. And so all of a sudden you assume that when you see this person in the gym that's doing this exercise, you go, oh, that's stupid, and oh, you point it out. But the reality is, I have no idea what their desired outcome is.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I have no idea what they're training for. It could have massive application for what
they're trying to
accomplish. Yeah, and it may be ridiculous for 99% of the population, but how dare I look at this movement that I think is ridiculous and silly, so long as they're performing it in a controlled fashion and they're not going to hurt themselves. And I think that a lot of trainers jump to that conclusion that, like, oh, well, that's a great example of this is the Jefferson curl.
Yeah.
Right? So if you've ever
that has to be the one exercise that looks like, oh my gosh, you can't do that.
If you see a Jefferson curl and you've never seen one before, right? If you see that for the first time and you're a trainer, it kind of breaks a lot of the fundamental rules that you've been taught for good mechanics for bending or hinging over, right? But that specific exercise is not supposed to be like a deadlift. It's supposed to be a different movement, and it's intended to strengthen and challenge all the muscles surrounding around the spine and your core, and if done properly can be a very phenomenal exercise. Yet I know that most people, I probably wouldn't train that, but I look differently at movements like that in the past I would probably go, or even here's another one. Look at LeBron James doing a quarter squat, or anybody for that matter. LeBron James is someone famous, but see someone doing a quarter squat, and then right away we want. I mean, there's pages dedicated.
You're not going ass to grass
to talking shit about these people that are doing movements like that when you don't know what this person does for a living. You don't know what adaptation they're going after. So who are you to judge whether that's a good or a bad movement?
Yeah, I think if you're experienced, you can watch someone do an exercise and notice that in many cases they lack the mobility, they lack the connection.
Right.
I could do that for I'd say the most part, maybe not every single time, but for the most part. But that being said, there's a lot of exercises that people write off because they say, don't do that, it's dangerous. The truth is, if you own the exercise, it's not dangerous. If you can do the movement well, there's nothing dangerous about what that movement is, and that's really it. So the blanket, you know, bad exercise, good exercise, or too dangerous, don't do it, nobody should ever do that. And Jefferson curl is my favorite because it's literally, you know, rounding your back, you're bending over, you're... But you know that exercise was a staple among gymnasts and Soviet era wrestlers. In fact, they did the Jefferson curl with a Zercher position, so they were bending all the way down, and it was a rounded back, and then round, and then
as long as
all
you can generate tension and you can maintain stability and control and strength in that position, like, it's a valid movement. And that's the thing; it's like the prerequisites to a lot of these movements. They need to apply. But as far as a judgmental trainer that's in the gym, I do find there's instances where you'll see somebody with terrible form performing a certain type of movement where it does warrant a conversation in terms of, well, you might not want to keep applying this technique to this specific exercise because it's going to, over time, and the stress may end up finding its way into, your joints, your knees, like your lower back. Like, there's a better way to perform and do these exercises. So I find value in, like making sure the quality element is there. But in terms of like your original statement of the exercise itself, there is a biomechanical way to pull it off as long as it's done with good form and the prerequisites are applied.
Well, listen, if there's ever going to be a time in your sport or your day where you're going to move in that range of motion, it makes sense to strengthen in that range of motion, i.e. the gymnast or the wrestlers. Yes. They're contorting their body in these weird positions. And so that you want to be strong in this rolled up extended position that you may not normally get in normal life, but if I'm wrestling on the ground with someone, if I'm folded over like a lawn chair, I want to be strong in that position.
Along those lines, let's say you strengthen your body with what's considered traditional perfect form, and you never strengthen your body in those positions.
That's how you get hurt.
And then you get hurt, right? Because you generate all this force, and then as soon as you move outside that position, you lack the stability and control to manage the force that you might have generated going into it. And that's how you get injured.
This is part of the reason why we see normal people get injured doing the most basic things like reaching back and feeding their kid in the back seat or pulling a weed from the ground or picking up a bottle of shampoo in the shower. These are some of the most basic movements, but because they're twisting and rotating.
And they never do that
in their training, then it doesn't take much for them to tweak something or to injure themselves. And so, again, you might see someone doing this weird rotating type of movement or motion inside the gym and go, oh, that is stupid or dangerous or you shouldn't do it. But the truth is, if you do that sometime in your day-to-day and you're not strong on that, you're at risk.
Now, a big part of that, and this needs to be made very clear, you have to own the movement, right? So you can, look, I'll tell you what, the most basic movement, a barbell curl, can be very dangerous for somebody who lacks the prerequisite skill, mobility, and connection, right? A simple exercise like a barbell curl could be dangerous for someone. Barbell squats all the way down can be dangerous for someone, or they could be very safe for someone, right? It depends on, do you control the weight? Do you have the stability, the mobility? Are your joints supporting the weight in the sense that, your end of range of motion is your spine, or is it the muscles that are supporting your spine? This is all very important. You use the example of a gymnast. I had a gymnast that worked for me years ago. I learned so much just from watching this guy because he would do movements like he would do dips and he would go so low in the parallel dip bars. And I remember thinking, oh, his shoulders have got to be wrecked. And yet he had some of the healthiest shoulders
the
of all time.
The opposite ends up being true.
And I remember talking to him about it, and he goes, oh, yeah. He goes, I couldn't do that when I first started training. Mm-hmm. He goes, I had to really build the strength and stability to be able to do that. But now I have so much control in that range of motion. Now, if I tried to do that without building up to it, for sure I would hurt myself. Now, it is true that not all exercises are created equal. And that some exercises, if your form is off a little bit, the risk goes up quite a bit. Usually it's the compound complex lifts. But nonetheless, movements, if you can do them right and you control them right and you have the stability, they're not dangerous. My favorite examples are the behind the neck exercises, behind the neck pull down, behind the neck press. Like Olympic lifters do behind the neck presses all the time. In fact, they catch the weight on their traps all the time. Most bodybuilders would hurt their shoulders doing that because they don't have the stability to do it.
Yeah, I got to give a bit of a shout out. It's I think his handle is Atlas Power Shrugged, but I follow this guy, total unconventional lifter, bringing back a lot of the really old school movements and barbell movements, bent presses. Mm-hmm. He does things where he's doing like a clean behind his back, and he'll do like hack squats and things, with a barbell behind him.
Those are old school.
Really old school techniques, but it just, for a common person walking by, they would probably be like, whoa, stop, you're gonna hurt yourself, what are you doing? You know, and this guy's like showed his whole process of getting strong in these old school movements and built himself up to be resilient enough to pull these movements off.
Yeah, really the injuries occur, and they can occur with any exercise. And of course, like I said earlier, some exercises, if you go outside of perfect form and control, the risk goes up dramatically, whereas with other exercise, the risk doesn't go up so much. But if you hurt yourself doing an exercise, it's because you didn't own it. That's all it is. Like, you either use too much weight for the type of strength that you have, you lacked the stability, you lacked the mobility, you just didn't own the exercise, and that's why you got hurt. That's the only reason you get hurt. An exercise won't hurt you if you own it, and I don't care what the exercise is. So you see videos of these trainers and coaches saying things like, you know, don't do side laterals with your pinkies higher than your thumb because it could place your shoulder and shoulder impingement and whatever. Mm-hmm. Not if you own the exercise. Now, I will agree, it's more complex. It requires more stability. It requires different strength and stability that maybe some people own. But that doesn't mean the exercise is dangerous. And again, I like to point to those behind the neck exercises because, like, behind the neck pull downs, you know, in the 60s and 70s, that was a staple at pull ups. They would do behind the neck pull ups all day long.
Well, in defense of the trainers that used to, because I was part of this group that used to talk shit about the behind the neck everything and going deeper than 90 and the deep dips and all that stuff, your national certifications said that. I mean, I remember being at least two or three national certifications deep in a couple years' experience.
Yep.
That's my point.
They said, don't go down below 90 degrees.
I was literally that guy who was training behind a client when they were doing like dumbbell bench press and letting their elbows would touch my hands. Okay, back up. You know, or their dips, I would have my hand where their chest would hit. Okay, back up.
Yep.
You know, I didn't want them going deeper than that because I thought it put them at risk because that's everything. That was what we were taught. We were taught to do that. And, you know, it's so funny because I don't think I ever thought to challenge that. It just made sense. Like, oh, yeah, you know, that's putting them at risk. Why would we do that? And I can stimulate the muscle just fine by going just down to 90 degrees. But, you know, it never dawned on me like, yeah, you stop doing that and you lose the ability to do that. So what happens in real life when you accidentally move in that range of motion?
Yeah, when you can move like a robot your whole life?
Yeah, like it just didn't dawn on me until way later in my career.
Same thing. My first certification was not even a national cert. So when I started with 24 Hour Fitness, they had their own certification.
Apex.
No, it was
24 Hour Fitness University.
Yes. And I remember when this was 97. And I remember the instructor explaining why we should not go all the way down on a bench press. So he said, stop at 90 degrees. And then what he did is he had a towel. This was his example. And it like stuck with me. I'm like, oh my God, that makes sense. He said, this is what it's like when you go all the way down. And he took the towel and he twisted it really tight. And then he started bending it. He's like, this is what happens to your shoulder. And of course, I don't question him as the instructor.
Right.
So I taught everybody at 90 degrees. Yeah. Later on, I understood how the scapula moved and the shoulders moved. And I read books on evolution, how we have this incredible mobility and control with our shoulder. One thing we evolved with is these incredible shoulders allow us to throw with accuracy and all that stuff. And I remember thinking, what if I just strengthened that position and was able to move within that? And then I started training that way. And of course, you get better results. But it's, you know what it reminds me of? It reminds me of when people say, always lift with your legs because they're so afraid of their back. So everything looks like a front squat when they pick things up. Yeah. And it's like, okay, what you're basically doing is you're trying to remove all potential risk by limiting your range of motion so much. But the reality is if you do that all the time, you are actually setting yourself up for more potential injury in the future because then that's all you know how to
do. That's exactly what happened to me. I mean, I had more shoulder issues, more hip and low back issues in, you know, my early mid-20s than I do now 40
years old. Doing everything at 90 degrees.
Because I was shortening everything up. And that's what you don't realize, too, is that you're not only are you shorting up, but then you're getting really strong and tight in that position, which is even worse. You'd be better off not doing anything, you know, and like what, just see where life takes me than to get really buff in the shortened range of motion, because then you have all this power and strength, but then you have no control in where the body technically could go.
Hey, if you enjoyed that clip, you can find the full episode here, or you can find other clips over here, and be sure to subscribe.